What's up, y'all? I'm DJ Premier, and I present to you So What's Up.
Okay, computer. Run it back.
So What's Up. I'm going to take you back to 1992, our second album on a major label, because we started out independent. Wild Pitch Records, shout out to Stu Fine, who signed us independently. He actually signed Gangstar before me, before I joined the group. Our first major was Step in the Arena in 1991, but we felt like Step in the Arena was more of our debut album collectively, because our first album, No More Mr. Nice Guy, was still learning how to just do production and make beats, so I wasn't really on the level that I am now, so we shared production. It was me, Guru, and our engineer, Slow-Mo Sonnenfeld, who had a studio called Such a Sound. That's where we used to do all of our stuff in Brooklyn at the time, and that's when I met King of Chill, who's a legendary producer of MC Light, the Audio 2, the Alliance. He was also part of that group. And, you know, Positive K, Missy Me, MC Peaches, and on and on and on. Daily Operation, we felt like this is our sophomore album, and when you make a debut, just like any artist that goes platinum or blows up with their first, you know, release, even though it's our third release, to us, we felt like it was our sophomore album, and people always expected, can you do it again? We went really, really deep on this album, and plus, it was the first time that we moved to D&D Studios. Shout out to Lord Finesse for booking the session. Shout out to Showbiz for having me come down to lay scratches on the remix that he did for Return of the Funky Man, and that's how I ended up at D&D Studios, which became our only spot to work at from that point in my career for almost the next 27 years. Shout out to Dave and Doug, who are D&D. First, before I do anything, name of the song. Name of the song is Take It Personal. Now, let me explain two things to this, the equipment and song. The equipment I was using at that time was the SP-1200. There is an SP-12, which did not have a floppy disk available. The SP-1200 did. Now, at that time, that's what I was using. I wasn't on an MPC 60 yet. That's how I met Eddie Sancho, who was my engineer for over 27 years. He was the one that did the session for Lord Finesse. That's what led me to moving on to a different piece of equipment, which I'll explain later. But first, since I was on the SP-1200, I got to shout out an engineer who actually recently just passed away. His name is Lyle Leet. Lyle worked with De La Soul, Queen Latifah, the Jungle Brothers, Ultramagnetic MCs at a studio called Calliope. So many people worked at this studio, and I ended up doing Step in the Arena at Calliope because of all these artists, and I was looking for a certain sound, dirty but still crispy. Lyle Leet came with me when I went to D&D to continue working on Daily Operation. That's where these transitions started to change. I was working in what we call the A room. D&D had an A room and a B room. Now, the famous B room that everybody knows me for hadn't happened yet. We were working in the A room and did the entire album there.
What happened with the switching of the equipment?
Eddie Sancho was looking at the way I lay my tracks down, and he tells me, hey man, in order for you to make it easier for yourself, you should use the MPC 60. That's what I use, and let me show you how. Once he showed me how it worked, I was so fascinated by the different ways that it could really enhance my production style that I moved on to that. What I did do is I said, the last song we're gonna do on the album, I'm gonna use the SP-1200 one more time. And if you notice, on the disc, it says SP-1200 right in the corner, because this is the very last time I ever used that equipment ever in my career. But the sound of it is so dirty. I had that drum break in that song for so long. This is even when I was in Texas, and I never, ever, ever put a song to it. Started looking for samples that would fit the vibe of it. Looked it up, loaded it into the good old SP-1200, and as it goes, like this. I've never made a cadence of a drum break like this, because I did a double kick every time that I hit it.
with hip-hop videos, we were into making dope videos just like any other artist. And for us, at the time, Ralph McDaniels, Video Music Box, and Lionel Martin, we call him the Vid Kid, they had a team called Classic Concepts, and they were doing all the dopest videos. They did Cream for Wu-Tang Clan. They did Can It Be All So Simple. They did all the Boys to Men videos where it would be black and white, but you would see the color of blue in their jeans. That was their vibe. Hype Williams comes from their camp in the early stages before he was a director and doing videos. And even Lil X from up in Canada, same thing. But since we always watch Video Music Box all the time, we have to definitely get them to do a video for us, which we did. Shout out to Big Shug, who's one of the original members of Gangstar. It's crazy because he had just come out of prison, getting them back into the fold of how things were going down with the music business, because things had changed from the time that he was doing music. And I remember when we said, we're going to put you in the video so people would know who you are, and eventually you're going to start doing your music. If you're looking to take a personal video, you see Shug is going to do the part where he ties the string around the guy to hang him. But he said, don't move until we tell you. If you look in the video, you see Shug do a little step, and it's like, not yet, not yet. And they didn't edit it out, but it's still there. So shout to Big Shug and shout to that mishap, but it's memorable. Got to get Classic Concepts to do the video. And again, it was so high in demand at that time that it was so important that we had a video with them. And the one thing that actually was dope is as they moved forward and got bigger and bigger, they ended up doing Code of the Streets with us on the next album for Hard to Earn. Now, when it came down to me using this drum machine, the SP-1200, for Taking Personal, I moved into what you call the B-room, because we always do B-sides that are not on the album. Came to that B-side, it ended up being a song called Dwick. Now, when we moved to the B-room, it was only because the A-room was booked and I wanted to get the song done so that we could put it on the B-side and turn it in so we could get the single out on vinyl. Wouldn't you know, Dwick turns out to be such a hit that I said, from now on, I'm staying in the B-room. That's how the famous B-room became famous. So we gotta give a big round of applause to Take It Personal for happening the way it did. Because if it wasn't for that, probably would have never had Dwick. Shout to Greg Nice and Smooth B for joining us on such a big classic record. And Recipes to Guru. Gotta salute the floppy disk.
So Premiere drops beats for me to say verses to. And if I sound doper, then take it personal.